audience of physicists of various specialties on the occasion of the anniversary of relativity. So I just hope it won't be too simple for this audience.
No, it's never too simple.
Okay, so, okay, this is the list of topics that I want to talk about. Essentially, these are the most important successes of relativity during this 100 years of its existence. So, the prehistory of general relativity begins with the creation of special relativity. General relativity is the extension of special relativity that covers also gravitational phenomena. So, the basic postulate of special relativity is that every inertial observer will measure the same velocity of light. This postulate can be written as such an equation. And Hermann Minkowski in 1908 noticed that transformations between inertial frames that preserve the equation delta S squared equal to zero preserve not only this equation but also the value of this whole expression. And on the other hand, in Euclidean geometry, the distance between points of Cartesian coordinates x, y, z, and x plus delta x, and so on, is given by such a formula and is preserved by rotations. So, from the similarity between these two equations and their properties, Minkowski concluded that special relativity is, in fact, the geometry of a space which is today called Minkowski space-time. Einstein had found out already before that date that the gravitational field can be simulated by acceleration. And the transformations that preserve this expression, well, it, for short, it's called metric form, or mathematicians hate it when we use the word metric for something that is not positive definite, but okay, it's just shorthand, and we know which theorems not to use when we refer to that in this way. So, these transformations that preserve this expression are linear in the variables t, x, y, and z. So, in a transformation to a reference system that moves with acceleration, the new coordinates will be arbitrary functions of the old ones, and then the coefficients of this form after such a transformation will no longer be constant. Here is a very simple example.
But okay. This t prime is a different dimension than t.
No, that depends what is the dimension of t prime.
Yeah,
how do you know it's
that what I said, it has different dimension
right.
than t?
Yes,
that's what I said.
Yes, of course.
And what's wrong with this?
Nothing.
That's correct. So after the transformation, you see we get a non-diagonal component here, and one of the components is no longer constant. So the conclusion is, if acceleration imitates gravitational field, so a gravitational field should give the same effect. In a general spacetime, the coefficients of this form should no longer be constant, and the form will no longer be diagonal. And, well, the men who create the foundations of such a geometry were created much earlier, about 50 years before. Namely, they were created by Bernhard Riemann, who introduced them in his habilitation lecture. That's a curiosity, because habilitation lectures are rarely that meaningful, in 1854. His idea was to replace the Pythagoras formula with a symmetric quadratic form, quadratic in differentials of the coordinates, in an n-dimensional space, so that the distance between the point of such coordinates and the point of such coordinates is given by this formula. And, well, the idea to interpret gravitation as a modification of geometry, of space-time, well, it had to be supplemented with equations that would generalize Newton's laws of gravitation. So I won't tell you, won't show you these equations, because then I would have to use too much time and space, but they are complicated. But it's enough for you to know that the Einstein equations are differential equations of second order, built of the components of the metric. And these differential expressions are equated to zero when we look for solutions in vacuum, or to 10 components of the energy momentum tensor that represents the energy density and the distribution of pressures and tensions in the source of the gravitational field. In the Newtonian limit, that can be formally recovered when we treat the velocity of light as a parameter and go to infinity with it. In the Newtonian limit, one of those equations goes over into the Poisson equation, and the other ones are fulfilled identically. That means they turn into zero equals zero. Okay, so this was general relativity in a capsule. And then let's go over to the testable results. So the first, to discuss the first testable result, we have to go back several years again. So in Newtonian physics, an orbit of a planet in a spherically symmetric gravitational field in polar coordinates, in spherical coordinates, is given by this equation. R and phi are polar coordinates. This is the parameter. Okay, this is an equation of an ellipse. This is the parameter. This is the eccentricity of the ellipse. This is the connection between the geometrical and physical parameters. Okay, and the star is at one of the foci, of this ellipse. Okay, but this equation of the orbit results under some simplifying assumptions. Namely, we neglect several interactions. We neglect that, we assume that this interplanetary space is perfectly empty. So we neglect the presence of radiation, of solar wind, of micrometeorites, and also we neglect the presence of other planets. Okay, in the case of orbits of planets, all those assumptions except one are justified. The one that is not justified is the neglection of other planets. Namely, if the gravitational fields of other planets are taken into account, then in the so-called post-Newtonian, well, that's still Newtonian, sorry. If we take into account the influence of other planets on any single planet, then its equation of its orbit is modified in this way. This coefficient here appears, this is a constant characteristic for each orbit. And as you can see, in order to reach again the same distance from the Sun, the planet has to circle the Sun by an angle somewhat greater than 360 degrees.
Question, is this in perturbation, some kind of perturbation theory, this result?
Yes, that's a very complicated calculation.
But isn't so that the major contribution to the Mercury is not from the other planets, but from the shape of the Sun?
No, no, it's actually negligible. That was tested.
I do remember that in the attempt to formulate another theory of gravitation by Dickey,
yes,
that shape of the Sun was crucial
for his theory.
No, but this is meant that the problem is that when Einstein and the others were there, were performing the first calculation, and Eddington was performing the first measurements, there was no real experiments on the shape of the Sun.
But no, but they relied on the experimental observations that were not correct. This is
they were not correct.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, I don't want, it's a long story, which I can tell you on some other occasion, but I don't want to go into it now, because this will be...
The answer is that that was, in some sense, mistake.
Non-sphericity of the sun is negligible. Dicky, okay, I don't want to go into it. Okay, so the orbit given by this equation as this shape, you can imagine it as the planet still going around this, the sun on an ellipse, but the ellipse at the same time rotating in the same direction by, okay, this angle is much exaggerated because the fastest precession of the perihelion observed in the solar system for Mercury, it's about 1/6 of a degree per 100 years. You may have seen other numbers. I will explain in a moment where the differences come from. Okay, so this is when you recalculate everything into the heliocentric system. Observations are made on the Earth. So out of necessity, the raw observational data include the influence of Earth's orbital orbit, and you frequently see instead of this number the number 5599. Okay, so this influence of Earth's orbital motion was already subtracted here, and this is the quantity that has to be explained. So of these 600, 280 is caused by Venus, 150 by Jupiter, and 100 by the remaining planets. And this much was known already in the first half of...
Mars is missing. Is Mars not?
The remaining
no, Mars is too far to... Okay,
it's
within this country. Jupiter counts separately because it's very big, and Venus counts separately because it's very near. Okay, and the other planets are here. Yeah. Okay, this much was known in the first half of the 19th century, but then the question arises, does this sum up to what is observed? And the person who asked this question and answered it was a French astronomer, Urbain Le Verrier, and he published his results in 1859. He calculated all those contributions to the perturbations of Mercury's orbit, added them together, and well, found out that the sum is by this amount too small to explain the whole effect. By today's measurement, this discrepancy is equal to this. For the other planets, the corresponding quantities are in the range of a few seconds per 100 years, and this wasn't possible to observe in 19th century. So this discrepancy became the greatest, one of the greatest mysteries of astronomy of the second half of 19th century. And the explanation came together with relativity. This was actually the first success of general relativity. Namely, in the same year, 1915, Karl Schwarzschild found the first exact solution of Einstein's equations that describes the gravitational field in vacuum around a spherically symmetric star. And the equation of a single planet in such a field, in the post-Newtonian approximation to relativity, has exactly the same form. And when the appropriate quantities are substituted into this equation, then the velocity of the perihelion precession of Mercury, calculated from relativity, is this much. If Mercury were the only planet in the solar system, its orbit would still not be elliptical, but would have this shape, with this angle being equal. And you can see this agrees very well with the observed value. Now, I said this was the first success of relativity, but it didn't cause much of a sensation because the effect was known earlier, and relativity only explained it. I will come back to that. Now, today, the second best known example of such an irregular orbital motion is the double system consisting of this pulsar and the second neutron star, was discovered by 1974 by Russell Hulse and Joseph Taylor. This system lies about 21,000 light years from the Earth in the direction of the Aquila star system. And okay, in the rest frame of the system, the period of the pulses of the pulsar is 59 milliseconds. And it turned out that this period changes periodically, and the observers concluded that the changes in period are caused by the orbital motion this neutron, of this pulsar around the center of mass of the system. And these changes allowed them to calculate parameters of the orbit. So here, for comparison, you have the perihelion of Mercury, which is 46 million kilometers. Now for the pulsar, the periastron is 770,000 kilometers. So it's this fraction of this quantity. The up astron is 360,000 kilometers. Again, it's just a fraction of the perihelion of Mercury. Mass of the companion is 1.4 solar masses. So from these numbers, you can see that this pulsar moves in a much stronger gravitational field than Mercury. So the effects of general relativity are much more pronounced. And well, you can see this from this number. For Mercury, it was 43 arc seconds per 100 years. For this pulsar, it's 4.2 degrees per year. Okay, for these measurements, these two gentlemen got a Nobel Prize in 1993. I will mention this pulsar once more later in my talk. Now, the second application of relativity was for the bending of light rays in a gravitational field. And this was also possible, the calculation was made possible by the Schwarz solution. So a light ray that is emitted by an infinitely distant star, if it's tangent to the surface of the sun, should be deflected by this angle, 1.75 arc seconds. Okay, and the R is the radius of the sun in this case. It's actually the parameter of the light ray with respect to the center of the gravitational field. So you can see that when R increases, the deflection angle decreases. Okay, and the first confirmation of this prediction was achieved in 1919 by two expeditions of observers, and the whole event was organized by Arthur Eddington. So this is the principle. Okay, this is the scheme of the measurement. So one has to find two stars that are seen just at the edge of the sun during a total eclipse. It's a difficult astronomical exercise in itself. But once such stars are found, okay, T1 and T2 are the real positions of those stars, and the directions to them are at an angle alpha 1. That's how it is seen when the sun is away from the field of view. When the sun comes into the field of view and is seen between those stars, then the rays are deflected, and the observer sees the images of those stars in the points A1 and A2, and the angle between them is alpha 2. So that's what Arthur Eddington intended to measure, and he organized two expeditions, to Sobral in Brazil and to the island of Principe in the Guinea Bay, because these were the places where the eclipse was best visible. Well, these are his results, and this is the prediction of relativity. Okay, the prediction is actually slightly off the first measured result, but anyway, this was counted as a great success, and this result catapulted Einstein to the great fame that persists until today. Now, later, much later, this is an analogous observation, was made with a greater precision by another method. Edward Fomalhaut and Richard Stamek in 1974 measured the deflection of radio waves from radio sources. I tried to find their pictures and biodata in the internet, but I just couldn't identify which of the numerous data referred to precisely these two persons. Sorry, so that there will be no pictures. Okay, the principle is this. There are three radio sources in the sky, schematically depicted here, such that each year, for about 3 weeks, in March and April, the sun passes over the image, image of the middle source. So the other two are sufficiently far from the sun's trajectory in the sky, so that their positions are not perturbed. So when the sun is out of the field of view, well, they are these sources lie very nearly on a straight line. Then you can measure all of their positions and remember the position of P2 relative to the other ones. When the sun comes near to the middle source, its visible image is displaced. You can measure where it is seen in the sky, but then you can, using the coordinates of the other two, you can calculate where the real image should be. So in this way you can estimate this angle. And the deflection angle measured in this way, divided by the theoretical result, well, this result. This was a much more precise confirmation, and I'm actually surprised that these two astronomers, radio astronomers, are not famous basically. So I don't know why. This was a very elegant measurement. Okay, and another consequence of deflection of gravitational deflection of light are gravitational lenses. This is, in fact, the same phenomenon. A gravitational lens is a configuration consisting of a light source, a deflector, and the observer, who are placed in space in such positions that the rays emitted by the source and deflected by the lens here intersect again at the position of the observer. And well, today the theory and observations of gravitational lenses developed into a separate branch of astronomy. Well, the lenses are usually much more complicated in shape than the spherical shape. And you can see from this formula that, well, unlike optical lenses, the gravitational lenses, they don't focus the rays. Yeah? The ray that is flying farther from the center of the deflecting object is deflected by a smaller angle. So you can't expect to view anything through a gravitational lens like you can view objects through optical lenses. The image is strongly deformed, but using some heavy calculations, you can relate the shape of the image to the shape of the object. And, well, this is an example of what is actually seen by observers. Okay, this is the deflector, and these arches here, they are images of a more distant object produced by deflecting its light rays. In astronomical practice, the deflector and the objects whose rays are deflected are quasars. So they are very far from us. Okay, the next field of application of general relativity are gravitational waves. So the existence of gravitational waves was first predicted by Einstein in 1916. And I don't want to go into the theory because it's complicated and these are linearized calculations. Okay, it's all complicated. So let me just tell you that gravitational waves are in many respects similar to electromagnetic waves, but there is one important difference. The gravitational interaction is a lot weaker than the electromagnetic interaction. So, for example, if you take two electrons, then the gravitational attraction between them is by this factor smaller than the electrostatic repulsion. So the gravitational radiation emitted by objects that could be accessible to direct observations on the Earth is too weak to be detected. Let me give you one example. That's actually an exercise taken from one of the textbooks on relativity. Suppose a meteorite of mass 20,000 tons hits the ground with the second cosmic velocity, 11 kilometers per second, and stops after penetrating the rocks to the depth of about 200 meters. So these are the estimates of the parameters of the meteorite that really hit the Earth some 50,000 years ago, and there is still a crater to be seen near the town of Winslow in Arizona. Okay, so the total energy radiated out in the form of gravitational waves during this collision would be just sufficient to throw upwards one proton by 120 meters, so about this high. So for comparison, the double star Sirius, which is about one of the weaker astronomical sources expected to radiate gravitational waves, it's 8.5 light years away from us. For this star, the predicted density of energy stream on the Earth would be 30,000 times greater than from this collision. So, to inspire your imagination, this is the crater in Arizona. This is the road leading to the crater. This is the visitor center where you can see movies, hear to the guides, watch exhibitions. The diameter of the crater is about 1200 meters. The depth from the rim to the bottom is 170 meters. Okay, and such a big collision would produce gravitational waves just sufficient to throw upwards one proton. So the attempts at detection are all aimed at astronomical sources, possible astronomical sources of gravitational radiation. So imagine a circle with small masses symmetrically distributed along the circle, and assume that the simplest kind of gravitational wave, namely a plane-fronted gravitational wave of constant polarization, hits the circle from the direction perpendicular to its plane. So it's expected that the gravitational wave would force the masses to oscillate like this. First, the circle would turn into an ellipse, then back into the circle, then into an ellipse with axis perpendicular to this one, then again to the circle, and so on. And the first person who attempted to detect gravitational waves in early 1960s was Joseph Weber at the University of Maryland. His detector, seen in this picture here, was an aluminium bar of 2 meters in length and 1 meter in diameter. And it was expected that because of this effect that I showed in the previous picture, this bar would vibrate in response to the gravitational waves passing through it, and the vibrations would be detected by piezoelectric sensors mounted around it. Now, Weber reported, soon after he set up this experiment, he reported that he detected a signal coming from the direction of the center of our galaxy. But calculations showed that if his report were exact, then there would be a huge stream of energy emitted from the center of galaxy, much larger than that could be accounted for. nobody was able to duplicate his result. And now it's believed that the result arose from a computer failure. But Weber is now acknowledged as the pioneer who started the experimental search for gravitational waves. Now, today, the most often used type of detector for gravitational waves is a laser interferometer. I suppose I don't have to explain to anyone in this room how it works. This small picture here shows the field of forces in the gravitational wave. And, okay, this interferometer, okay, the light, these light beams travel in tunnels of a length of 4 kilometers, and to avoid all disturbances, the mirrors have to be cooled to as low temperature as possible, and in the tunnels where the rays travel, the pressure must be lower than 10 to minus 12 atmospheres to, okay, again to prevent the disturbances. Now, the parameter used to estimate the expected strength of the signal is this. It's the change of, okay, delta L is the distance between the observed masses before the gravitational wave arrived, and delta L is the change in this distance. So this is the parameter that is used to calculate the expected effect. And for the expected astronomical sources of gravitational waves, this parameter is contained between 10 to minus 22 and 10 to minus 19. Okay, the left, the lower limit is for the pulsar that I already mentioned. The upper limit is for the eclipsing binary star Mu in the constellation Scorpio. So at room temperature, the thermal vibrations of atoms have a greater amplitude than this. That's why every detector has to be cooled to as near absolute zero as possible and has to be isolated mechanically as precisely as possible. And for the best now existing interferometers, the parameter A that they would be in principle able to measure is contained between 10 to minus 20 and 10 to minus 19. So you see that in principle, this range is contained within this range, but there are technical difficulties. Namely, the main difficulty is to maintain the full power of the laser for a sufficiently long time. Okay, and so far, well, it wasn't possible to achieve this sensitivity in continuous operation.
And the frequencies are so costly, right? Because what you gave is for a binary motion, and the measured frequency range is much higher. It does not cover the binary.
That's another trouble, yes.
That's also
good. Okay, so this is one of the existing observatories in Livingston, near Livingston in Louisiana, USA. These are the 4 kilometer tunnels where the rays travel. This is an abbreviation for Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory. This detector works in pair with another one in Hanford, Washington, some 3,000 kilometers away. So the two detectors working together, they make it possible to estimate the direction from which the gravitational wave will come when it's detected, and also to discard perturbations, because then you watch only for such signals that have the same time profile in both detectors. And so far, gravitational waves were not detected directly, and the only indirect evidence for their existence is this pulsar that I already mentioned twice. So its orbital period and the radius of the orbit decrease with time at such a rate as if gravitational waves were carrying out energy from the system. So this is the graph that shows this effect. The blue curve is the prediction of general relativity, prediction for the change of the period as a function of the date of observation. Red points are come from observations, but there is a secret hidden in this. Namely, this is not a direct result of observations. It's the observers used a model of the orbit of the pulsar that contained some 10 or 15 free parameters and fitted everything together so as to reproduce this result. So Hals and Taylor got the Nobel Prize not for detecting gravitational waves but for the very precise measurements, which was quite an achievement in itself. Yeah? But gravitational waves are not counted as already discovered, and that's why the chase to find to detect them still goes on.
Why do you need a model? Two bodies revolving around each other?
The bodies may have different shapes. There can be matter between them, and
accretion.
We don't know their parameters.
Ellipticity, orientation of the
single model of two bodies does not predict anything. So
yes, it does.
This kind of a shift.
Not with this precision.
So that was
one more comment. This is the most precise observation, but of course there are other arguments in favor of gravitational waves. And for example, Paczynski was one of the few people who many years ago explained the binary evolution just by the existence of gravitational waves. You have to lose angular momentum from the system to evolve them.
Okay, but it's still somewhat disturbing that we don't see them directly. And until we see, there is always some...
just a technical problem.
If they exist. Okay, so the next application of relativity is something observable, is the precession of the axis of a gyroscope on the orbit around the Earth. So in relativity, the rotation of a massive object directly influences its gravitational field, not in the same way as in Newton's theory. In Newton's theory, the only way that the rotation of the source of gravitational field can influence the exterior field is that the body is flattened because of the centrifugal force, and then the exterior field is no longer spherically symmetric. In relativity, there is an additional effect. Namely, if the central body is rotating and you shoot a test mass at it from a certain distance in the direction of its center, it will deflect from this direction in the same sense as the rotation. And, well, it's a very small effect. I will show you the numbers in a moment. And one of the consequences of this effect is that a gyroscope on the orbit around the Earth, the axis of the gyroscope, should precess. Now, this precession has still another source that would be there even if the source of gravitational field didn't rotate. Namely, there is the spin of the gyroscope interacts with its orbital angular momentum, and that results in geodetic precession, which is actually much larger than this. Okay, so the influence of the rotation of a gravitating body on its exterior gravitational field was first calculated by two Austrian physicists, Hans Tilling and Josef Lenz, in 1918. And the experiment to measure the speed of precession of the axis of the gyroscope was proposed by Leonhard Schiff in 1960. And the equations used by Schiff were first derived by a Polish physicist, Miron Matyson, in 1937. Okay, these are these gentlemen. I will tell you about this one on the next page. We didn't hear about him yet. Okay, well, I usually don't tell you about details of biographies, but his biography is exceptionally interesting, so let me tell you a few sentences. He was a physicist, of course, by the time he published this famous paper. Not only a relativist, he was writing papers in different areas of physics, but later in his life he became an inventor and constructor, and he is shown here together with his most famous invention. Namely, in early 30s he constructed a movie camera and a projector that were able to register and transmit not only images but also sound. This was quite an achievement for that time, and his apparatus was used for several years to show a weekly chronicle of events in Austrian cinemas. But that's not the end. After the war, he became a politician and peace activist, and for his peace activities he was twice nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize. He didn't get it, but Austria owes it mainly to him that it became a neutral country without an army, and that the world forgot and forgave the Austrians their participation in the Second World War on the side of Hitler. So quite a remarkable figure.
He also had a physicist's son.
Yes, Walter.
Very, very, very famous.
Yes, Walter. He died very recently. Okay, you know Leonhard Schiffer, the author of the textbook on quantum mechanics that most of us probably use. Josef Lenzer was a professor of mathematics in Munich later in his life, but he was equally famous for the piano concerts that he played every week in the halls of the university. Okay, so let's go back to physics now. So the experiment with measuring the precession of the axis of gyroscope was carried out by a group of physicists from the Stanford University under the guidance of Francis Everett. This was the man in the colorful photo on the previous slide. And the predicted rate of precession of the gyroscope's spin was 6.60 arc seconds per year for the geodetic precession and 0.039 arc seconds per year for inertial frame training. So from the numbers you can see how difficult the experiment was. From the beginning of the work in 1963 to the first announcement of results in 2007, 44 years passed by. The total cost of this experiment, named Gravity Probe B, was $750 million. Fortunately, this man lived long enough to take care about this experiment all the time. And here you have the result. This is the experimental result, this is the prediction of relativity, and see how beautifully the result agrees with the prediction. Now, a few words about the difficulties. From the moment when the rocket was launched until the end of measurement and instrument calibration, it was 17 months, okay, in this period. And throughout this time, the four gyroscope had to keep rotating with minimal disturbances. So the whole experimental setup was cooled to 1.8 Kelvin in order to use superconductive shielding of magnetic disturbances. And all of this had to keep the temperature for this long high above the Earth. There was no access to it. So the isolation had to be perfect. Now, to eliminate mechanical instabilities of the gyroscopes, which were made of quartz the size of a ping pong ball about this large, had to be spherical to maximal precision possible. And okay, the authors of the experiment advertised the precision. They say that this was those gyroscopes, they were the most precisely spherical objects ever made by human beings. And if the gyroscopes were increased to the size of the Earth, the largest hills on them would have 2.4 meters in height. Okay, this is the illustration showing the gravity probe beyond orbit. the orbit was about the Earth's poles. The reference direction was the axis of a telescope pointing all the time to this star. Okay, this is the formula if you care to look at it. And these four little spheres here are the gyroscopes. There are four of them to increase the precision. And actually, this was also a very ingenious setup. Namely, the gyroscopes themselves were flying in a cavity inside the body of the satellite. And of course, for such a small object, the other disturbances that I mentioned earlier, like solar wind, even radiation pressure, micrometeorites, and so on, all of this causes disturbances that influence the result. So all those hits are taken by the body of the satellite, and the gyroscopes fly undisturbed inside the cavity. And if the sensor detects that the body of the satellite changed its proper position with respect to the gyroscopes, then corrective jet engines would put this outside satellite back in the proper position. So that's very ingenious, I think. Okay, and now the last application of relativity that was already carried out, it's to the global positioning system. So it's now a famous name, everybody knows what the global positioning system is. It was launched in 1977, initially only for military navigation. It was made accessible for civilians in 1989. And initially, the civilian version of the system had artificially reduced precision. Namely, civilians can measure the position only with the precision up to 100 meters, while the military precision was 5 to 10 centimeters. But after a few years, this shielding of the big precision was abandoned because ingenious civilian engineers invented ways to bypass this limitation anyway, so the American military gave up on the attempts. Okay, so the GPS satellites move on 6 orbits, regularly spread over the Earth, inclined at 55 degrees to the equatorial plane, and 4 satellites on each orbit. So many satellites to give a chance to every person on the surface of the Earth to see 4 satellites simultaneously, at least part of the day. Yeah, that's necessary for the localizers to work. 4 satellites must be in view at the same time.
At least 4.
If there are more than 4, then the precision increases. Yeah? But less than 4 is
a simple result.
So each satellite sends impulses of electromagnetic waves that carry information about the instant of emission and about the position of the satellite at that instant. And, well, you will see in a moment why 4 satellites must be visible. So let these 4 sets of coordinates refer to 4 satellites at the instant of emitting the signal. Now, these are the coordinates of the receiver on the Earth. And since special relativity tells us that the velocity of light is the same in every inertial system, these coordinates have to obey this equation here. Okay? So if you have data about x, y, z, I, and t, I from the satellite, for 4 satellites, then you have, this is a set of 4 equations in which x, y, z, and t are the 4 unknowns. This can be solved. And these quantities are calculated by computers in the satellites and sent to the Earth. And on the Earth, they are verified and corrected by the central ground station. And okay, the control and correction signals are sent by means of electromagnetic waves. And together with the clocks in the satellites, and clocks on the Earth, all those clocks are in the gravitational field of the Earth. So as relativity predicted, a clock which is placed in a stronger gravitational field runs slower than a clock in a weaker field, and also, of course, slower than the hypothetical ideal clocks that would be in a perfectly empty space-time, far away from any gravitational field. So the calculation shows that in each second, a clock on the surface of the Earth stays behind the ideal clock by this amount, yeah, of the order of 10 to minus 10 seconds. Well, it seems not to be a meaningful time, but during this time, light travels the distance of nearly 21 centimeters. And this error in position occurs every second. So, if this effect were neglected, the comparison of time shown by the clock on the Earth with the clock on the satellite would cause an error in determining the position, in every second. So during 24 hours, the error would grow to 18 kilometers, and the whole system would become useless even for pedestrians. So this effect was predicted in 1979 by Neil Ashby from the University of Colorado at Boulder. This is not the only influence of general relativity on the measurements in this system. Namely, oblateness of the Earth also has influence, because of the oblateness, clocks on the pole are in a stronger gravitational field than clocks on the equator. The altitude of the clock, for example, if the clock is placed in an airplane 10 kilometers above the Earth, this can also influence the precision. Rotation of the Earth, that has a special relativistic effect, because the clocks on the equator are moving with a great speed with respect to the inertial system. This is okay. You can see the other errors are rather small. Also, the gravitational field influences the clocks in the satellite. The error caused by the clock in the satellite running late with respect to the ideal clock would be this much during 24 hours, and this is again a special relativity effect. Okay, so all these effects have to be taken into account in order that the GPS runs as it should. This is Neil Ashby, and okay, we can say that every time when one of us gets to the planned destination using a GPS localizer, we, with our own hands, carry out an experiment that confirms general relativity. Now, this is what relativity has done so far. Now, let me make a projection into near future. Namely, well, as you all know, the light that comes to us from distant objects in the universe is redshifted. Can imagine this effect in such a way that if photons propagate through expanding universe, that then they get stretched, and when they arrive to the observer, the frequency is reduced. And a measure of the stretching commonly used in astronomy is called redshift. This is the difference between the frequency at emission minus the frequency at observation divided by the frequency of observation. Now, you heard, of course, that the current models of the universe say that in recent times the universe has been expanding with acceleration. Even a Nobel Prize was awarded for this discovery. Well, it's easy to imagine. Okay, now imagine this as a word line of the source of light. This is a word line of of the observer, and imagine light signals being sent between them. Okay, so if this region of the universe is expanding with acceleration, then the photon that was emitted later will be propagating through a universe that is expanding faster than the first photon. Okay, So the redshift for the later photon should be greater than the redshift for the earlier photon. If the universe is expanding with deceleration, then the redshift for a given fixed source should be decreasing with time. Okay, and this kind of observation was not possible to carry out until now, because the expected, this effect is called redshift drift, and the expected magnitude of redshift drift is between minus 4 and plus 0.5 times 10 to minus 10. But there are now prospects to measure this effect in near future. Namely, the orbital observatory Gaia, which is already working, but it's working on different problems. The purpose of this observatory is to determine the distribution of mass in our galaxy with high precision. But the machinery that this observatory contains has sufficient precision to measure this small change of redshift during 30 years of monitoring of a selected light source. And this is something independent of a model. And we look at a fixed source of light and check whether the redshift is decreasing or increasing. Well, I said continuous monitoring. It's not necessary to monitor it continuously. It's enough to measure the redshift in some intervals of time.
Now, so they will measure quasars, but it will be very difficult to get this kind of precision, I mean, because of the variability in the
sure,
sources.
It's difficult, so that's why it was not done until now, but possibilities exist. Now, the European Extremely Large Telescope, this is the official name, it's still in the design phase, it should be built in Chile in the near future. It should be able to measure the same effect during 10 years. And like I said, this effect would be independent of any model. So if the universe has been expanding with acceleration recently, then for nearby sources, the redshift should be increasing with time, and for distant sources, it should be decreasing. Now, if the universe has been expanding with deceleration all the time, then the redshift should be decreasing for all sources. So this will be a critical test that will objectively show whether the acceleration of expansion is a real effect. And that's all I wanted to tell you.
Thank you very much. Questions?
Ja ten mam taką historyczną uwagę, że do pierwszego parę slajdu, która jest związana też z pewnym pytaniem. Mianowicie, to wszyscy wiemy, że to Riemann sformułował po raz pierwszy geometrię, dziś nazywaną niewidosowską, czy tam riemannowską, ale już zaraz potem człowiek, który, dzięki któremu praca Riemanna w ogóle się przebiła do środowiska matematyków, czyli Clifford, który ją przetłumaczył z niemieckiego na angielski, napisał w swojej książce, że to jest mechanizm do pisania grawitacji. I nawet w książce Clifforda jest to, co rozumiem, jest bardzo ważną informacją, że pole grawitacyjne jest związane z krzywizną czasoprzestrzeni, a nie z tensorem metrycznym. I jakaś ta cała książka Clifforda, która odegrała gigantyczną rolę w filozofii i w naukach społecznych i jest jakoś kompletnie przez specjalistów od ogólnej teorii względności ignorowana i przynajmniej takich popularnych.
Ja założę się, że profesor Trautmann nie wie.
Tego nie wątpię.
Nie, bo to była taka idea jakościowa, ale nie przekuta w konkretną teorię matematyczną.
No więc tego to ja właśnie, to ja się panu pytam, panowie jesteście specjaliści, ale w tej książce, znaczy prawdę powiedziawszy, że ja nie dotarłem do tego, ale w tej książce Common Sense of Science, gdzie ten cały rozdział o krzywiźnie przestrzeni i grawitacji Clifford zawarł, które zresztą jest niezwykle proste napisane, bo każdy to może zrozumieć pewnie lepiej niż wielu innych książkach, to tam jest cytowana jakaś jego praca, taka bardziej matematyczna. Ja i do niej dotarłem, więc też nie umiem.
Ja też tego nie znam, ale prawdziwy start teorii względności to były równania Einsteina.
Nie, ja tam
miał pomysł, żeby powiązać grawitację z krzywizną przestrzeni już kilka lat wcześniej. Ale jak to zrobić matematycznie, to trochę mu czasu zajęło.
No nie, no ale tak samo jak Minkowskiego wzory, no to Poincaré też przedtem napisał, prawda? Więc to nie jest tak, że to wszystko jakoś tak wpływało w tym geni. Był jakiś geniusz loci tego przełomu stuleci, w którym te wszystkie teorie się razem.
Tak, no, historycy nauki, nawet takie tematy, jak pan wspomniał, to w ogóle osobne prace i osobne prace. Nie miałem szansy tutaj o takich szczegółach mówić.
If there are no more questions, we'll thank you again.